Good evening, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of Jesus Versus Classroom. This episode is going to be the last episode for the series we started with, which is the series on heat energy. You know, that's been a long journey. We dealt with temperature and its measurement. We dealt with heat transfer. We dealt with calorimetry. We dealt with thermal expansion and contraction. And then finally, we are today going to deal with evaporation and humidity. So let's set the ball rolling. Like I always say, if you have not subscribed to my YouTube channel, which is BJ Online, please do that. It's very important. Whilst you do that, turn on the notification button so that anytime a video is uploaded, you get a video and you watch it. Thank you. So let's begin. Evaporation and humidity. So we look at evaporation and humidity. So what is evaporation? We said that evaporation is the process whereby molecules on the surface of a liquid are able to escape into the gaseous state when they gain enough energy. Now, because evaporation is a surface phenomenon, it takes place only on the surface of a liquid. The molecules on the surface of the liquid must gain enough energy to be able to escape to the gaseous state. So let me use the kinetic theory to explain the concept of evaporation. Now, what happens is that when heat is supplied to a liquid, the molecules of the liquid increase the temperature, or the temperature of the liquid increase. As the temperature increases like that, the intermolecular force between the liquid molecules gets separated, because the intermolecular force becomes weak. So the molecules get separated, you know, from each other, because the intermolecular force has become weak. Now, as a result of that, the molecules then gain kinetic energy and they begin to vibrate about their main positions vigorously. Now, as this continues, it gets to a point where the intermolecular force becomes so weak such that the molecules at the surface of the liquid gain enough kinetic energy and they are able to escape. What this means is that the weak intermolecular force between the molecules is going to get broken for the molecules at the surface of the liquid to escape to the gaseous state, from liquid state to the gaseous state. At that point, we say evaporation has taken place. Good. So we look at a simple experiment to show that evaporation is followed by cooling. Now, what happens is that this is a phenomenon which is very important, and the applications of evaporation is based on this principle, that evaporation is followed by cooling. To do this, we obtain a saucepan. We put the saucepan on a table, and we pour some small amount of water on the table so that, remember, the saucepan must be a very good heat conductor. Then we put a volatile liquid into the saucepan. Then we put a stirrer in the saucepan. So before we begin with this experiment, we put a thermometer inside the water, which is outside the saucepan on the table. Of course, we clamp it to make sure that the thermometer is standing firm. So we clamp it. Then what happens is that We've determined the initial temperature of the water on the table. Then we stir the liquid. So as we stir the liquid, what happens is that because the liquid is volatile, as we stir to increase the surface area, we facilitate the rate of evaporation. So after the liquid evaporates, we realize that the level of mercury inside the thermometer begins to drop. It begins to drop. So at a point when we realize that the level of mercury has fallen to some appreciable value, we stop the experiment, then we determine the final temperature of the system. Then we realize that the final temperature theta 2 is less than the initial temperature theta 1. What this means is that as the liquid inside the saucepan evaporates, cooling takes place, and so the water on the table lose some amount of temperature. This temperature reduces from theta 1 to theta 2. So this is a simple experiment to show that evaporation is followed by cooling. Good. So we look at some factors that affect the rate of evaporation. We have temperature. Remember that evaporation occurs at all temperatures. Evaporation does not occur at a particular temperature, it occurs at all temperatures. But increasing temperature increases the rate of evaporation because increasing temperature causes the intermolecular force of attraction between the molecules to become weak. And for that matter, increasing temperature increases the rate of evaporation. Number two, we have surface area. When the surface area of a liquid increases, the rate of evaporation also increases. Then we have humidity. Humidity, the higher the humidity of the atmosphere, of the environment, the surroundings, the lower or the smaller the rate of evaporation. Let me explain this. What happens is that when you pick a closed system, gas molecules, these vapor molecules, exert pressure on the surface of the liquid. So that pressure, which is exerted on the surface of the liquid, prevent the molecules at the surface of the liquid to gain enough kinetic energy to be able to escape to the gaseous state. So for that matter, the higher the humidity, the lower the rate of evaporation. Good. And then we talk about wind velocity. Now, the higher the wind velocity, the higher the rate of evaporation, because you realize that if wind velocity is high, it is going to blow away the just escaped water vapor to cause the air, surrounding air, to become less humid. And for that matter, the rate of evaporation is going to increase. Then we talk about the nature of the liquid. Different liquids have different intermolecular force of attraction between the molecules. So if a liquid has less or weak intermolecular force of attraction between the molecules, then that liquid is likely to evaporate easily. If a liquid has higher intermolecular force of attraction between the molecules, that liquid will not evaporate easily. Thank you very much. So we look at the applications of evaporation. Applications of evaporation. One of them is sweat or sweating or perspiration. When we say sweating or perspiration, it's a situation whereby the surface of the skin, begins, water moves from the inner part of the skin to the surface of the skin. That is sweating. Now, when sweating takes place, see, as air blows on the surface of the skin, evaporation occurs on the surface of the skin. So, but because evaporation is followed by cooling, anytime somebody sweats and evaporation takes place, the person loses some amount of heat. And when this amount of heat is lost, the person feels cold. So this explains the reason why, we all have been watching football. When you watch the EPL, you realize that when, not only the EPL, in the advanced countries, when player is being substituted, you know, whilst he's going to sit down, he's giving a jacket to wear in the person. It is going to reduce the rate of evaporation, which will let him, help him to conserve heat so that he does not lose so much heat, which prevents him from catching cold so that he can be fit for the next match. So that is the rationale behind, you know, people being given jacket to wear when they are being, footballers being given jacket to wear when they are being substituted on the pitch. So that is one application of evaporation, which is sweating and perspiration. Then we talk about the earthing wear pot. You know, in our local setting, we call it cooler. So this earthing wear pot is designed such that they use clay to make it. And there are small pores on the surface of the clay. So when water is poured on into this earthing wear pot, and the water is left for some time, the water inside the cooler or the heating well will get cold. Why? Because as the water trickles down, trickles through the pores to the surface of the pot, this water at the surface of the pot gets evaporated. But evaporation is followed by cooling because latent heat is taken away from the system. So what that means is that as evaporation takes place on the surface, the earthing wear pot gets cold, the water inside the earthing wear pot also gets cold. So after some time, we realize that the water in the earthing wear pot is cooled because evaporation is followed by cooling. And when evaporation takes place, latent heat is taken away, so the system cools. Then we talk about the refrigerator, which is another device that use the concept of evaporation to operate. Now, the refrigerator has a liquid called refrigerant. So the refrigerant evaporates, latent heat is taken away from the freezer or from the fridge, so the fridge cools, then it rises up, get condensed, come back and get evaporated again. So it uses the concept of evaporation and condensation in a cyclic manner to get the inner part of the fridge to cool. That is another application of evaporation. Good. So, what happens is that there are some technologies that we are supposed to do so far as this particular topic is concerned. So we look at some of these terms. Let's look at an unsaturated vapor. So a vapor is said to be unsaturated when the rate of evaporation is greater than the rate of condensation. You know, in a closed system, as a liquid evaporates, condensation also takes place because at the top part or at the part where the vapor, the lid of the container is exposed to the atmosphere, you know, the lid of the container or the top part of the container, because it's exposed to the atmosphere, is cold. So as the vapor rises up, it gets to that cold region and then it condenses and falls back. So, as evaporation is taking place, condensation is also taking place. So, the situation whereby the rate of evaporation is higher than the rate of condensation, we say that the vapor is unsaturated. So, the pressure of such a vapor, we call it an unsaturated vapor pressure. Then what happens is that the evaporation continues to take place, you know, as other factors change, the evaporation continues to take place until the point is reached when the rate of evaporation is equal to the rate of condensation. At that point, the vapor contains the number of molecules it is supposed to contain at that particular temperature. At that point, we say the vapor has reached a saturation point. So a saturated vapor is a vapor in which the rate of evaporation is equal to the rate of condensation. Now, if a vapor is in that state, we call such a vapor, we say that such a vapor is a dynamic equilibrium with this liquid. Now, a vapor is said to be in dynamic equilibrium with this liquid when the rate of evaporation is equal to the rate of condensation. So what that means is that the amount of molecules present in that vapor, water molecules present in that vapor, is always constant because the rate of evaporation is equal to the rate of condensation. So we can also define saturated vapor as a vapor which is in dynamic equilibrium with this liquid. Is that clear? Good. Then we talk about supersaturated vapor. A supersaturated vapor is a vapor which contains more molecules than it is supposed to contain at a particular temperature. So let me explain this. How can we cause a vapor to become saturated? You know, what happens is that to become supersaturated, what can we do to make a vapor become supersaturated? You know, what happens is that when a vapor is saturated, we say the vapor contains molecules that it is supposed to contain at that particular temperature. You know, for instance, at 20 degrees Celsius, let's say a certain vapor or certain volume of air is supposed to contain 200 grams. A certain volume of air is supposed to contain 200 grams at 20 degrees Celsius. So when the air contains 200 grams at that temperature, we see the vapor is saturated. So at 15 degrees Celsius, we don't expect the vapor to contain 200. So what happens is that we wait for 20 degrees Celsius, amount of water molecules present to 200 grams, and then we quickly reduce the temperature from 20 degrees Celsius to 15 degrees Celsius. So at 15, we don't expect the air or that volume of air to contain 200 grams. But at this point, at 15, it contains 200 grams. This particular type of vapor is referred to as supersaturated vapor. So let's look at properties of a saturated vapor pressure. Properties of a saturated vapor pressure. We say that it does not obey any of the gas laws, the Charles law, the pressure law, the Bohr's law. It does not obey any of the gas laws. It is not affected by change in volume. Alright? So a saturated vapor pressure is not affected by change in volume. And then it depends solely on temperature. Saturated vapor pressure depends solely on temperature. So let's look at boiling. Boiling. We say boiling occurs when the saturated vapor pressure of a liquid is equal to the atmospheric pressure. Boiling takes place when the saturated vapor pressure of a liquid is equal to the atmospheric pressure. Alright? So, when the saturated vapor pressure of a liquid is not equal to the atmospheric pressure, the liquid will not boil. So, a liquid will boil when the saturated vapor pressure is equal to the atmospheric pressure. Remember that boiling is not the same as evaporation because boiling takes place in the whole container. Evaporation takes place only on the surface. Evaporation takes place at any temperature. Boiling occurs at a particular temperature. Alright? So there are differences between boiling and evaporation. They are not the same thing. Good. And what is boiling point? Boiling point is the temperature at which boils is what we refer to as boiling point. So boiling point is a particular temperature, alright? Good. Factors that affect boiling point. We have impurities and then we have atmospheric pressure. When impurities are present in the liquid, the boiling point increases. And then when the atmospheric pressure is also high, boiling point also increases. The lower that atmospheric pressure, the lower the boiling point. Good. Then we talk about melting. Melting is a situation whereby a solid changes to liquid. So the process of changing solid to liquid is what we refer to as melting. Now melting, just like boiling, also occurs at a particular temperature. It occurs at a particular temperature. So melting point is the temperature at which a solid changes to liquid. The temperature at which solid changes to liquid is what we refer to as melting point. Factors that affect melting point, the same two factors that affect boiling point, the same two factors that affect melting point. We have impurities, then we have atmospheric pressure. Then we look at humidity. Humidity is the measure of the amount of water vapor present in the atmosphere. The amount of water vapor present in the atmosphere, the measure of that is what we refer to as humidity. Then we talk about relative humidity. Relative humidity. We define relative humidity as the amount of water vapor in the air compared to the amount of water vapor needed to saturate the same air at a particular temperature. The amount of water vapor present in the air compared with the amount of water vapor needed to saturate the same amount of air at that particular temperature. This is what we refer to as relative humidity. Good. So when we talk about amount, amount here, we can mean mass, we can mean volume, we can also mean density. So we can use density to explain it. We can use mass to explain it, and we can also use volume to. So for instance, in terms of mass, we say that relative humidity is the mass of water vapor in air per the mass of water vapor needed to saturate equal volume of the air at the same temperature. You know, these definitions are technical. So when you're defining them, make sure that you are on point. Good. So the instrument used to measure relative humidity, we call that instrument the hygrometer. Hygrometer. So the simple hygrometer that, you know, at our level we are supposed to know is the wet and dry bulb hygrometer. Now the wet and dry bulb hygrometer comprises of just two ordinary thermometers. One of these thermometers is hung in air, which we call the dry bulb. Another one is placed in a blanket which is soaked in water. You know, part of the blanket is inside the water, whilst the other part is outside. So the part of the blanket which is outside and still soaked with water, we put that bulb, that thermometer, inside that blanket. That thermometer is what we refer to as the wet bulb. So the one in air is called a dry bulb. Then what happens is that the thermometer in air is measuring the atmospheric temperature at that time. The thermometer inside the blanket is measuring the temperature of the blanket as evaporation takes place in the blanket. Remember that the smaller the humidity, the higher the rate of evaporation. The higher the rate of evaporation, the more latent heat is taken away from the blanket and the more the blanket cools, because evaporation is followed by cooling. For that matter, after some time, the temperature difference between the wet and the dry bulb is determined, and then this temperature difference is compared, or yes, it's used to compare to, you know, temperature difference on a chart. There is a chart that demonstrates a particular temperature difference and its correspondence, its corresponding relative humidity. So what happens is that the greater the temperature difference, the higher the humidity. Alright? The greater the temperature difference, the greater the temperature difference, the lower the humidity. And the smaller the temperature difference, the higher the humidity. Let me explain this. When the temperature difference is high, then it means that the amount of water vapor present in the air is low. So you have more water vapor coming up for the blanket to cool, for the temperature in the wet bulb to reduce. But when you have more water vapor present in the atmosphere, the rate of evaporation is low. The blanket doesn't cool that much, and you know, the temperature measured on the wet bulb is so close to the temperature measured on the dry bulb, and so the temperature difference becomes small. This is the basic technology principle behind the usage of the wet and dry bulb thermometer, which we refer to as hygrometer. Thank you very much for being part of the BJ's Physics classroom. Take care of yourself. God bless you. Bye-bye.